Hi there, Doug Stuman with IT Creations with an HPE ProLiant DL385 Gen10 Plus V2 server. Yes, this is a Gen 10 server, and HPE has moved on to the Gen 11, but it does support third generation AMD EPYC processors. That's what that V2 on the end means. Actually, let me start over. That 5 on the end means the DL385 supports an AMD EPYC CPU. The plus, as in the DL385 Gen 10 Plus without the V2, means support for first gen and second gen AMD EPYC CPUs, but not third gen. The DL385 without the Plus or V2 supports first and second gen, but only to a TDP of 200 watts, and half the memory of the other two at 4 terabytes compared to 8. With the Plus V2, like on this system we have, the third generation CPUs, but also support for second gen. Well, let's get to it. Given the same socket, I'm not sure why the myriad of CPUs supported on the other two DL385 Gen 10 systems couldn't have been handled with a firmware and BIOS update to bring them all up to support for third gen processors. That said, HP is probably never going to send us anything ever again. I was just kidding, HP. But then again, was I? By the way, if you like our videos, hit that subscribe button. Maybe go for the combination by hitting the thumbs up button too. This server, and just to be clear, since I've almost confused myself at this point, the ProLiant DL385 Gen 10 Plus V2 server is designed for machine learning, deep learning, big data analytics, plus private cloud and low-cost virtual machines, given the core count, memory, and storage. Yes, indeed, this system does support graphics and compute accelerators. In fact, up to 3 double-wide cards and up to 8 terabytes of memory. And I will start by saying this platform has many options. Many. You can install the optional bezel with optional security lock if you want a little bling. There are several storage conditions for this server, depending on your needs. Looking at the front, you can see it is divided into drive bays 1, 2, and 3 on our 2.5-inch chassis. Each of those bays can be outfitted with up to 8 SFF SAS, SATA, or NVMe drives. A universal media bay is only available on certain configurations and only supported in the first of the 3 sections. With all 3 storage bays loaded with drive cages, it can support up to 24 SFF drives, including all NVMe. With 24 bays, you don't get the universal media bay. The 24-bay small form factor configuration also supports up to 8 SFF drives in a mid-tray drive carrier and up to 4 SFF drives in the back of the chassis for up to 36 SFF drives total. The LFF drive form factor is also supported with either an 8-bay version with universal media bay on top, an optional dual drive cage, or a configuration with 12 LFF drives up front and the option to install 4 more in the mid-tray and 4 more in back for up to 20 LFF drive bays. That last one, no universal media bay. Are you interested in the HPE ProLiant DL385 Gen 10 Plus V2 server? If you are, then for a limited time, you can save up to $500 off the purchase price of a system that's listed or one that you can configure that's valued at $5,000 or more. I think we can all agree that saving a few bucks is a good thing, as Martha Stewart says. Does she still say that? Or was that before her incarceration? I don't know. Click that link to find out more about the DL385 Gen 10 Plus V2. And when you're ready to make a purchase, just mention this video. I will mention a few disclaimers. The 8-bay NVMe SFF chassis can be upgraded to support 24 SFF NVMe drives with the addition of 2 more drive cages in front. I will also note that you cannot upgrade the 8-bay LFF chassis to 12 bays. At least that's what QuickSpec says. U.2 or U.3 NVMe drives are supported, but they cannot be mixed. Most likely you'll just get an error message. If you do install any of those rear drive cages, it shouldn't be a surprise that you will lose some PCI slots. There are also various fan options depending on the storage configuration, CPU TDP, and installed GPUs. The SFF chassis configuration has a small control panel with power on button, health LED, NIC status LED, and USB 3.0 port, with ILO service port below that. The first bay can also be outfitted with a universal media bay, but again, only on the 2.5-inch chassis. That bay offers an optical drive plus a few more USB ports, display port, and below those, 2 optional 2.5-inch drive bays. There are not as many telltale LEDs or ports on the full 12-bay LFF configuration. However, on the 8-bay LFF chassis, the universal media bay is similar to the 2.5-inch version and offers the same functionality. An optional dual 2.5-inch drive bay can be installed on the left. Some of those units can also be outfitted with an optional System Insight display panel pullout. That panel provides more information with LEDs for power, processors, PCI risers, temperature, power cap, dims, and fans. LED colors are amber, green, or red, depending on status. Embedded into each ProLiant server is HPE's Integrated Lights Out Standard Management Utility, or just ILO, along with intelligent provisioning. Like the name suggests, Lights Out can access the system even when it's powered down and remotely using a standard browser interface. HPE OneView is also available with the download and provides a more comprehensive view of your entire infrastructure. Both can be used for provisioning, maintenance, and can be a big help when you're deploying new servers. That said, ILO is the one-to-one option, while OneView is a one-to-many option. ILO Advanced, Advanced Premium Security Edition, and OneView Advanced all require additional licensing, but also more capabilities are enabled. As there are a myriad of options for the storage and controller panels on the front of the system, the back is no different. Lots of options. Dual redundant PSUs on the right with several wattages depending on how you configure the system. Most of these power options also require various power inputs. To help you make the right choice regarding PSUs, HPE does offer the HPE Power Advisor tool. I will add a link to that in the description. Ports on the back include the optional serial port, optional tertiary riser slots 7 through 8 above that can be also configured with a dual slot 2.5-inch drive cage, then a video port, OCP NIC 3.0 mezzanine card slot. Ours has a dual port 10 gigabit Ethernet Broadcom adapter installed. We also have a 1 gigabit quad port PCIe card installed. Optional secondary riser slots 4 through 6 above, assuming you don't install the optional drive cage, also supporting two 2.5-inch drives. The primary riser slots 1 through 3 on the far left can also be configured with an optional 2.5-inch drive cage supporting two drives. Below the primary riser, there is a dedicated ILO management port and dual USB 3.1 Gen 1 connectors with UID LED beside those. Another option is to install 3.5-inch drive cages in the primary and secondary risers, each with support for two 3.5-inch drives. Opening the case, you can see the primary, secondary, and tertiary riser locations. Moving a bit towards the front of the system, more options for drive bays with a mid-tray 4-bay 3.5-inch drive cage setup or 8-bay 2.5-inch drive tray. Both mid-tray options mount right on top of the CPUs and memory modules in a special mid-tray carrier with air baffles on top. The CPU is also limited to 225 watts or lower with the 4-bay LFF or 8-bay SFF mid-tray. In front of that, a fan cage with 6 fans. You can either pull the whole unit out with the levers to either side or just a single fan. Right in front of the fans is the drive backplane, and between the two, a place where a capacitor might be mounted for an HPE Smart Array drive controller. With support for SAS-Z and NVMe storage devices, this system does support tri-mode storage controllers. HPE Smart Array SR controllers will support a Smart Array storage battery. At 96 watts, it can support up to 24 storage devices in the event of a power outage, usually for about a minute, more or less. A Smart Array hybrid storage capacitor will support up to 3 devices. Controllers for drive bays include the embedded controller, which uses the optional SATA port, Type A controllers for the Type A Smart Array controller slot. Type A is installed in a dedicated slot on the motherboard. It's a modular unit and does not use a PCI expansion slot. Type P controllers installed in the PCI expansion slots. How your storage is set up will affect the storage bay numbering in the system. The only one that seems to provide continuous numbering is when the drives are connected via SAS expander board. For NVMe drive types, if you want to install all 24 up front, then you will need the NVMe primary, secondary, and tertiary risers installed. Also high-performance fans instead of the standard fans. HPE also recommends installing SAS expander cards for drive cages located at the back of the system. A modular SAS controller, that Type A controller I was talking about, is installed in that slot right between the central memory module slots and secondary riser. It can be connected to an expander in the PCI riser. With the three risers, there are 3 PCI slot options for the primary and secondary, plus 2 slot options for the tertiary riser. There are even risers for the risers. I'm kidding on that last point. A maximum of 8 PCI slots is possible depending on your choice of risers. All slots are PCI 4.0 and can be bifurcated. If installing GPUs in the system, you will need to add the optional GPU risers and high-performance fans. You can install up to 3 double-width with one in each of the 3 risers or up to 8 single-width accelerators. You will also lose an expansion slot in each riser with double-width cards installed. The NEBS compliant riser kit puts a few limitations on GPUs and other riser options. Same can be said if installing the Tri-Mode LP Primary Riser Backplane Kit. There are a lot of restrictions associated with each of the riser options available, which I'm not going to get into. You might fall asleep. Now, I say some supported GPUs here because the A100 is not even listed in the Quick Specs GPU list, but it is mentioned in the notes for the risers and controllers. I've talked about the A100 GPU in a few of the other videos. So how about a few words about the NVIDIA A30? Ampere architecture based, it offers about half the performance across a number of workloads compared to the A100, but still delivers for AI, AI inference, and deep learning workloads. It's all about budget and applications. It supports MIG or multi-instance GPUs, so it can be divided up into four virtual instances. NVIDIA AI Enterprise, offering an end-to-end cloud-native suite of AI and data analytics software, is also certified to run on the A30 in conjunction with VMware vSphere. Our system is configured with dual AMD EPYC 7473X processors with 24 cores and 2.8 GHz clock. With an X suffix, it's one of the four third-generation CPUs offering AMD 3D vCache architecture. It offers 768 megabytes of L3 cache for better queuing at the CPU and, in general, better performance than the standard EPYCs, which have about a third of that L3 cache, in general. There are 24 DDR4 registered memory modules installed for up to 768 gigabytes running at 3200 megahertz. Load-reduced DIMMs are also supported and will provide the maximum memory capacity at up to 8 terabytes with 256 gigabyte modules in all slots. This build also features the modular tri-mode MR416i-A controller. You can also install an optional PCIe card with dedicated management port and dual SFP28 ports. Again, a large assortment of options with network controllers too. Options are the name of the game with the HPE ProLiant DL385 Gen10 Plus V2 server. With a 2U form factor, dual AMD EPYC CPUs up to 8 terabytes of memory, and support for up to 3 double-wide or 8 single-wide GPUs, it can support your AI and inference or VM workloads. I do hope you enjoyed this relatively quick overview of the DL385 Gen 10 Plus V2. If you want more information, I provided a few links in the description. You know, a data sheet, quick specs, that kind of thing. Or you can click that link right there and visit IT Creations for more, itcreations.com. Until next time, I'm Doug Stuman with IT Creations, and thanks for watching.